Okay, so I don't have any slides. A few reasons for that, but I did post a blog post. So if you were watching Twitter, it was about 2,000 words that I put, and I posted this last night. Actually, I think it was during Fred's talk yesterday evening. I decided to just open that up. So if you want to get the full story, then you can read that and link to it and discuss what's going on. This is the third time I've been at microXchg. I like coming here. I like just immersing myself in what's going on in microservices and hearing all the different, sort of the evolution of how people are thinking about it over the years. It's been very helpful. So I was very happy to be back again. I have a new job, though. So I'm going to start by just telling you about my new job and then about the topic that I wanted to bring up, which was around sort of shrinking microservices to functions generally in that evolution. So the new job is that I now work for Amazon Web Services, and I started last October. I've got a nice title, which I'm still trying to figure out what I want to do with it, but I got a VP of Cloud Architecture Strategy, which is sounds good. It's a new position, so I'm not taking over something. So I joined, and I was the one-person organization. So they expect you to hire people. So I hired somebody, and I'm hiring a handful of people right now. I'm doing three things for AWS. The cloud architecture strategy piece is mostly talking to customers, talking to executives and developers, and figuring out where the market's going, what is the next thing? What should we be thinking about? What are people struggling with? Where are the gaps? That kind of stuff. And I do a lot of executive briefings and talk to a lot of customers and try to work out how the world is changing and how we can get ahead of the things we need to do. So part of it, a lot of what I'm doing is outbound talking to people. I'm going to be staying on in Berlin next week and meeting some customers here and meet some customers in Munich. So everywhere I go, every time I go somewhere, I go visit customers. So that's, Amazon is a very customer-driven company, so that's kind of a key piece of what I do. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that we have all these AWS summits, and there are between 20 and 30 different summits around the world, and there's only so many places you can send Werner Vogels before he starts getting tired. So they wanted some more people who could present at summits, so I'm one of those more people, and I'm going to be doing about 10 of the summits this year. The keynotes, all the stuff, introducing the products and all those things. So I get to go stand on the big stage with cool slide decks behind me flashing around. So that's a cool thing. That starts in April, mostly in Asia for me this time. And I'm afraid I won't be back in Europe this year when I kept all the European ones. I get to do the Asian ones for the first time. So that's the second job. The third thing, as I was joining AWS, they said, well, we have this thing and nobody really owns it and we need to figure out how to do something better in this space. And that was around open source. So I'm creating an open source program office and a strategy and a sort of a, not exactly go-to-market, but a way to engage better for AWS in the open source communities around the world. And we have all these products we've built that are, will run open source projects for you. We'll run Elastic for you, or MySQL, or something like that. But we hadn't really got a program for going out engaging in those communities directly. We've contributed fixes back to Hadoop and things like that. And we've got some open source projects. And there are two main areas that I'm focused on right now. One is around containers. The ECS team, EC2 Container Service, they have an open source project called Blocks. And this was a new thing for AWS. We built it, we put it on GitHub, and the entire roadmap is on GitHub. It's not one of these things where every now and again we'll finish something and put it out to the public. We're building it collaboratively in public. So they just posted a roadmap for what they're thinking of doing over the next year, and they're looking for contributions. So this is it's a container scheduler thingy that helps people integrate into AWS better. So that's one kind of project. The other one is a bigger deal right now, and that's around machine learning. So the area I'm learning a lot right now is machine learning and deep learning and figuring out how to how that whole space has been evolving. It's something where when I was at Netflix, I I spent some time working on recommendation systems, so I have some ideas in this space, but it's moved on a lot. And what's really happened is the hardware has really made it possible to do some very interesting things. So we now have a single GPU with about 4 teraflops of performance. And a few years ago, 4 teraflops was a very large number. Now that's one chip. You can get 16 of those chips on a single instance. Right? That's lots of teraflops. And so how do you make that do something useful for you? Well, what you do is you show it lots of pictures, and you say these ones have cats in and these ones have dogs in, and then you show it a random picture and it tells you whether there's a cat or a dog in it or something. Or maybe you put all of your employee photographs in it and it recognizes you as you walk in the door, so you don't have to swipe your badge, it just says, hello, Adrian. Yeah, how you doing, whatever, right? It's then like the doorman at your apartment that you've been living there a year and just recognizes you, so you don't need to show your key, right? So there's a bunch of interesting things going on there. The project that we've been working with there is called MXNet, and that is a framework built at a university, and we've now got it as an Apache incubator. So we've helped sponsor taking a artificial intelligence project out to Apache, and there's a bunch of collaborators on that. So that's what I'm doing. And my fun project is I'm trying to take a radio-controlled car and take out the radio part and put in a Raspberry Pi and a camera and see if I can get the system to drive itself around a racetrack. So if you want to talk about that, there's a DIY robocars is the is the thing, and there's fast, cheap, and out of control is their is their tagline. So that's my new job, having a lot of fun. But this architecture strategy piece. So I've done a few blog posts recently. The first one was sort of future of cloud. The second one was Lambda everywhere, and I'll talk a bit about that later on. The third one that I just posted was about the evolution from of business logic, from being hiding inside a monolith to being distributed as microservices and then being broken into functions. All right, so that's the general area I want to talk about. And there's really three things that have driven that evolution, and sort of rounding off and simplifying. If you look at it as sort of a 10-year thing, think about what was the world like 10 years ago, what was the world like 5 years ago, and what is the world like now? And if you look at the technology, business, and people practices at those five-year intervals, we can see that those are what drove the architecture, the combination of them. And I'll sort of talk about three different drivers, three different dimensions that have driven this evolution. So if we start with 10 years ago, and many of you, I mean, we still have these machines, but 10 years ago, the state of the art, the best practice was a big ball of monolithic Java connected to a big schema database, and we got pretty good at building those. And if you tried to break your system apart, we used web services, you know, WS star, and we had SOAP and XML and all these cool things, and that was, you know, it was a bit more than 10 years ago that came out, but that was still kind of best practice 10 years ago. We were sending SOAP XML messages, and the networking at that time was mostly 1 gigabit network, maybe not even that in some places. So you've got a 1 gigabit network, and you're sending a SOAP XML message back and forth, and you look at how long does that take? It takes quite a long time, right? You're sending a big blob of XML over a 1 gigabit network, and processing XML takes quite a long time. Just recognizing what is in that document, it's quite a high overhead. When you read an XML formatted document, you have to parse the whole thing and make sure it's completely consistent and everything is right before you then go and look at what data is in it. That's kind of the way the decode works. So it turns out that web services were relatively slow, so we ended up with fairly large servers or services with relatively small numbers of messages between them, right? Just because the technology supported that. If you tried to do too many messages, it just took too long. So you couldn't break your big monolith into too many pieces. So in an end user or an API call coming into a system, an application, it maybe hit 2 or 3 services before it came back. Right, and that was really all you could do. Now if we look at where we are now, we have the network technology that's going on inside AWS, and this was described in last year, is now 25 gigabit. That's the individual fiber. So the machines are connected, the latest generation anyway, are connected on a 25 gigabit network, not a 1 gigabit network, right? And the messages we're sending are, you know, whatever, Avro, gRPC, if you really want to get clever, the simple binary encoding, which is, I don't know, maybe 100 times more efficient than XML on your 25 faster network. So you are at least 100, maybe 1,000 times more efficient at sending a message between two servers. You see? So now you look at, well, if I broke these things into pieces, I can break them into smaller pieces because I can afford to do 100 microservice calls just to return to, you know, some external request. Whereas when I was doing XML SOAP, maybe I could do two or three. So that's a technology change that has enabled us to break the system into smaller pieces. And this is one of the reasons microservices started happening, and is, and the grain size or the size of the service has now got to the point where it, you really just do one thing. So single responsibility, you make it just do that one thing. And we're getting down to smaller and smaller functions, basically. Now, we're breaking our microservice apart to the individual functions that make up that service, and we can connect all those together. And we can afford to make those connections. So that's a technology driver that just helped us give us the ability to spread everything into smaller and smaller pieces. So that's one thing. Let's look at another dimension. How much code do you want to put in something? Let's look at how long does it take to build and deliver that code. In the old days, well, it was going to take you, you had to go talk to a vendor and buy a machine and, you know, and get that machine stuck in the data center, and then you could deliver code to it. And delivering code was a very manual, complex project all on its own. So that's sort of the 10 years ago thing. Just people were just starting. Some people were automated, but the general practice, very handcrafted release processes. You have project managers, and you released maybe every 6 months or every once a year, and it was a big, complicated, horrible thing that people didn't like doing, and you needed lots of testing to try and make sure that this was going to work. So we then sped up a bit. Had agile teams delivering maybe every 2 weeks, doing sprints. So now they've got, well, okay, I need to automate this a bit more. And what we saw was automation and the first beginnings of DevOps, where people started saying, I'm just going to automate all these processes, and I'm going to take my array of machines that I've got, and I'm going to be able to update them using Chef or Puppet or CF Engine or something. And that I see that as the first wave of DevOps. And it got us to basically it was the operations people adopting agile practices and automation to get stuff done quicker. So that was great, but you still have got this problem that you still have this, you know, you have 10 machines there that you're deploying to, but what happens if you suddenly need 20 machines? So this is the second wave of DevOps, which is really where, when I was at Netflix, we got involved in, was to basically have public cloud, right? So with cloud, you've got the ability to provision on demand, whatever capacity you want. You can scale back down, you only pay for what you use. And that gave us the ability to build this elastic system, but it also put an API between development and operations. And some people sometimes call that NoOps, but basically it means that the developers are working against a set of platform APIs to get something done. And we were able to do kind of the second wave of DevOps was developer-driven, just automating away the operations that we used to do. And then making it elastic so that you could do blue-green deploys. So now when I want to deploy code, I just create 100 new machines running the new code, and I leave the old machines there, run them side by side, and once I'm happy it works, I remove the old machines. This was a radical. In fact, we had a big argument. People were saying, you're doing it all wrong. You're supposed to be using Chef. And no, we're just using autoscale groups, and we're just creating these new machines. And there is no need to use Chef or Puppet. Netflix's architecture never needed that. We're just going to deploy new stuff and create things from scratch instead of updating stuff in place. So this is, People call this immutable infrastructure or immutable code. It's not that the code doesn't change, it's just that you delete it and create another one, rather than modifying it using something like Chef. So this sped things up a lot. Now, that helps us also make smaller pieces, because now the cost of delivery isn't no longer 6 months, it's a day or a few hours or something like that. So you see, the number of people that are needed to come together to work on this shrunk. And you could have an individual developer producing an individual microservice and using all this automation to just roll it out whenever they needed to. Again, so this is a people practices, but it's really the delivery process that changed. So there's two more steps in this delivery process that have got where we've got even better. So, you know, if you're deploying a new autoscale group with a whole bunch of instances, the instances take maybe a minute or so to appear, and they take a few minutes to boot Java or whatever you're running and get warm up. So your deployment, and you pay for everything by the hour, typically. So you've got these deployments where it's sort of minutes to hours, and you can autoscale up and down. And that's quite good for sort of diurnal cycles, where it gets busy during the day and gets quiet at night or whatever. You can autoscale. You can track these relatively predictable kind of sine wave workloads. But then you look at what happens when your website is sitting behind a TV advert, right? And the TV advert says, visit this URL and go and do something. You get a big spike in load. What do you want to do there? You need to be able to respond more quickly. You don't know how big the load's going to be. And the first step at getting there was to move to containers. A container is really a process with a bit more isolation around it. So they start in a second or so, rather than a few minutes. So we've moved from minutes to seconds. And using containers, we're able to build, again, more fine-grain microservices. And then another thing with containers is we started to standardize these containers. So just about everybody probably is running the same Redis container and the same Nginx container, because it's whichever one is on Docker Hub that's the most recent one. You build with that. So now we've got, rather than custom building these services and rolling them out, we're starting to see very standardized, heavily used, well-debugged containers that encapsulate some convenient piece of functionality. So we're starting to get closer to building blocks. And if you go to a Docker conference, they give you little Lego kits with containers on them, because it's kind of sticking together Lego bricks is the model that you're seeing here. It's much more efficient if you pull down a copy of Nginx that, you know, a million people have already used, because you're pretty sure that that's fairly well debugged, rather than going and compiling it yourself with your own environment and maybe not getting it quite right. So that's the first step of efficiency, and that was really a couple of years ago that got to be a good way to do things. And finally, we've got down to things like AWS Lambda, and the serverless model, where you write your code and it doesn't actually get deployed until it gets called. It's just sitting there ready to be deployed, and it's not actually running anywhere. And when a request comes in, it wakes up. First time you do that, maybe it's 100 milliseconds or something, because you have to kind of shuffle everything into place. And hopefully, if you write it in Java, then it's whatever it took your Java thing to start up. But if you write it in Python or JavaScript or you jam some Go code in there or something like that, the startup time is pretty fast. So now you've got and the second time, you once it's warmed up a little bit, it's tens of milliseconds is quite common for launch time. So but you stop paying for it when you stop using it. So we've now gone from being able to deploy things by the second, but having to have a fleet of machines ready to deploy them, which we need to scale up and down, to having basically nothing there, but I can deploy in 100 milliseconds, and you pay by the 100 millisecond. And there's, you get a million calls a month for free on Lambda, and that's not bad. Every month you get a million, and you get the second million is 20 cents. So, you know, it's fine if you want to play at home, and maybe you don't want to run a million requests a second into that. You should just use containers, because your machine needs to be there all the time. But there's a lot of workloads where traffic comes and goes, and it's spiky. And if you think about what is inside your microservice or your monolith, there's a lot of different functions in there. And some of those functions just don't get used very much. right? Even if you think of a reasonably compact microservice, it's probably got several different paths through the code, and some of those functions get called once in a blue moon when something goes wrong, when whatever is happening. Maybe there's an update function, but it's sitting in memory. It's consuming memory all the time, but it's not being used. So if you break this into functions, the functions only get instantiated when they're used. So the memory footprint drops dramatically, right? The average memory footprint. So that's an efficiency. The CPU, you only pay for the CPU memory that you actually use. So the cost goes down enormously. And so this is becoming a really interesting new paradigm for delivery, because now a delivery is 100 milliseconds. Like, how long does it take to put your code in production? The answer is now 100 milliseconds. Right? So that's an interesting new way of thinking about building these small services. Now, that was introduced about 2 years ago. It's the first place it came from. If you think about S3, which is an object store, okay, we have objects, right? What are the methods on those objects? Get, put, delete, right? It's the HTTP request. Those were the methods. You couldn't add your own custom method to S3. But then Lambda came along. It was actually built out of that. So the very first place was, these are the methods for your storage objects. And whenever you do something to an S3 object, you can trigger, you know, if it's a get or a put or whatever, you can trigger a Lambda function to do whatever you want to it. And that function is given the object, and you can do whatever, you can put it somewhere else, you can modify it, you can resize the images, you can do all kinds of things. So the very first use of this was every time you performed an action on a stored object, you have a method. And then we went, well, okay, we need to add this to some other things too. So more and more of the core pieces of the system, the queuing system, Kinesis, the event stream, DynamoDB, so database, all of these started to have Lambda functions added as triggers. So now you can build an application out of these things. And the Lego bricks, the building blocks here, aren't just containers, they're services. So you have DynamoDB and SQS as your building bricks. And you start building an application, and you don't even have to implement these things. They're just sitting there. They run. So we're starting to see applications be built in ridiculously short time periods. And if you think about this, I came up with this analogy. Is that, let's say you want to build a model house, right? And I give you a ball of modeling clay. And I say, with that, if you're an artistic, creative person, you could make a fantastic any house you wanted, right? You can handcraft little bricks, you can paint it, you can do anything you like, right? The shortest possible time it's going to take you to build that house is probably a week, right? Because this is artistic process, this is serious work here, right? And you're expressing yourselves. But if I also give you a bag of Lego bricks, you know, it's 10 minutes maybe, you've finished. But if I give everyone, but there's not really any creativity in there. Right? Everyone's got the standard bricks. The house is going to have, its walls are going to be the same thickness, it's going to be roughly the same size, it's a multiple of the number of dots wide. You know, so think about when you're building systems, sometimes you need that creativity, but you shouldn't be, you know, it's like, you know, here's a Java compiler, start coding. That's creating from scratch. Here's a bunch of building bricks, you know, standard services, and here's some glue logic to hook them together. It's just radically faster, but it's much more constraining. So you have to get to learn how to use these bricks, and you have to put up with the fact it's a bit clunkier than you wanted it to be. Maybe you could have built it much more nicely if you had more time, but you've finished it. It's sitting there. I have a house. It took me 10 minutes. Done. Right. I was judging a hackathon at the Amazon reInvent conference, and I was amazed. They had 12 hours, teams of four people, in 12 hours built complete systems, really complicated, complete systems. And they weren't just a hacked-up prototype. They could be deployed in production at scale because they were built, everybody was using Lambda. Like, every hackathon that I've seen recently has been we're just going to use Lambda because I can get an awful lot of things built really quickly. So this was eye-opening for me. I hadn't realized, I mean, I had a vague idea that it was quick to build things, but just incredibly quick build times. So now you've got an interesting new capability, because if you can rapidly build something, and let's say you have a whole bunch of stuff in your data center, old applications, and somebody wants to move it to cloud. This is happening a lot now. So you take these apps and you wrap them in a container and you stick them in the cloud and you try not to touch the code. But maybe you should just rewrite them from scratch if you can do it in a couple of days or a week with a small team of people. So there's something interesting here, because the easier it is to build things, the more things that you're going to just build rather than keeping the old stuff. So there's a lot of tidying up to be done. So this is another thing that's driving this evolution of microservices into functions, is that the individual functions are often 10, 20, 30 lines of code. I mean, you can put whatever you want in there, but most of the ones I see that actually do something useful are really short. They're glue. They're the, you know, if you're sticking together Lego bricks and you don't want your house to fall apart, you have to put some glue on it, super glue or something. There's just a thin layer of super glue between these other things. Because think about how many lines of code are in DynamoDB or in an API gateway. That's a lot of code. And your glue in between is just configuration. And your business logic is mostly decorating an object or adding or routing something between things, right? It's a much, much simpler thing to work on. But you've got more constraints. Okay, so I've talked a bit about it getting more efficient, so you can do things in smaller chunks, and you can do things more quickly. There's also the human side of this, the human organization side, which is that we have, quite often we're organized, this is Conway's law, and typically when I'm talking to executives at the, you know, the senior management, the problem they've got is all people. Right. The only thing you can really change if you're a manager is the way you set out who you hire, how you organize them, maybe what budgets you give them. And yeah, you could tell them to use the technology, but they really should be picking technologies themselves. So if you want a certain architecture, you have to do the inverse Conway maneuver and sort of run, you know, set up the groups to be roughly the partitioning you want, and assume that those groups will form services that talk to each other. So that's becoming the new way of doing it. But we've seen people now make this transition. Sometimes if you have these siloed organizations, you have a team here, team here, team here, and they're all working independently, and you need to reorganize everybody to be a cluster, a small team, right, which owns something. So in the new world, you have a group of developers and a product manager that are a team. And this is, Amazon calls these two pizza teams, and it's one of the reasons why AWS is able to scale its engineering organization. It's now just huge compared to what it used to be, but it's still generating new ideas and technology very efficiently because of these small cellular groups that are given a lot of freedom to build something and work independently. So that's the new way of working. And if you're in an organization that's set up as a bunch of silos, if you try and go do microservices, you're just going to build a distributed monolith or a big mess, or find that this is very painful. So most of the people I see having big problems with microservices, when you dig in to say, well, we do a bit of the work and then we hand it off to this team in India, and they do a bit of the work, and then we have another meeting with these guys in some other part of the world, and say, no, okay, you're doing it all wrong. If you've got teams scattered around the world, each team should own fully a microservice and change it themselves. Maybe different teams own different parts of the life cycle. Maybe some are creating brand new things, other people are doing maintenance, and there should be handoff. But you should completely own and be able to modify a microservice without going outside a time zone. Right? You should just, like, hopefully you should all be in one room, or at least on one chat session, and have a small number of people. And what you're building is a high-trust little group, right? This is the key thing. And a lot of large organizations and a lot of government organizations are inherently low-trust organizations. So in order to get efficient, you have to create these little balls of little clumps of people that have very high internal trust. Everyone knows each other, everyone trusts each other, you can operate extremely effectively, and the low-trust interfaces between them are the APIs and the SLAs or agreements or whatever, so you have to have stable interfaces. And that's the same as the interfaces we have between organizations. So if I want to call a mapping in, you know, if I want to have a map in my application, I call Google Maps or something, right? There, if I want to talk to some telephone system, I'd use Twilio, right? Those are organizations which are outside, but I have a low trust standardized API between them. But if I'm sitting next to somebody building another microservice, I should have the same kind of low trust interface to them, right? But if I'm working inside a microservice, I need high trust for the people that are touching the insides of it. So this is the organizational principles that really help people to move much faster in this world. And we're seeing people evolving into that space. Okay, I'm gonna go to questions in a bit, but I want to talk one more thing about where this is going. So I talked a bit about building applications with Lambda and with functions. The second phase of this is that the cloud infrastructure itself started to emit events as Lambda functions. So every time I make myself a new instance, I can trigger a Lambda function at the point where it's created or destroyed or whatever. I can clean up after an instance by attaching a Lambda function to it. So now there's a whole lot of automation you can build. It's kind of like, it's the new bash scripting for your infrastructure, but these scripts are Lambda functions that are event-driven, and there's a whole new area of interesting things that you can do now, because now you've got event-driven infrastructure and chaining things together. So I have a new machine, I need to attach a volume to it. Well, I'll do that by having a Lambda function that figures out which volume it should be and does the attach, those kinds of things. So there's a lot of interesting stuff there. So that was the second phase, and I'm starting to see a few people building interesting tools in that space. Then the third phase is a really radical departure, and I don't think people really understand what's going on here. And this was announced recently. So, yeah, you have a cloud. There's a big data center somewhere. It's serverless, so you don't have to think about where it is. Cloud means data centerless. If you think about it, because I don't know where the data center is, I never have to visit it. I assume there's one there somewhere. Data centers still exist, but we call it cloud, right? So don't get over the word serverless, right? It doesn't matter. It just means you don't have to think about the server, right? Just like cloud means you don't have to think about the data center. Right? So you've got this code running in the data center, but you have a CDN that's reaching out beyond that data center out near your customers. And so there's this idea that you can put your Lambda function at the edge. It's called Lambda at the edge. And once you do that, you get a CDN. You hit the CDN and, you know, very low latency because you're close to the customers globally. You hit that, you can generate any, you can check a cookie. If you're not authenticated, you could forward the request to a login page. When you were just trying to read an image, you could rebrand the image, right? You could translate the image into whatever language. You could look at the incoming request and say, that request's coming from Germany. I will change the text on this advert to be in German, but I'm actually storing a single image in the CDN, and the overlay that's writing the text on it is actually in a Lambda function at that edge. So now, as a fully distributed, at the edge, low latency, reaching right into the customer, you know, close to the customers, just a few milliseconds away, you can put code. And this code is not running in the AWS regions. It's in the CDN endpoints. So this is, but it's the same programming model as you had for all the other Lambda stuff. So now you've got this much more distributed model for building applications, and we're still starting to explore what you could do with that. So that was one new thing. And then, well, there's always Internet of Things stuff. Well, you know, I have a thing. I want to be able to program that too. So I have this project called Greengrass, but just to put a Lambda function in the thing. So now that's not even a thing that we built. It's just somewhere there is a thing, and it has to have enough CPU and memory to run Lambda, so it's not like the totally tiny Internet of Things stuff. But, you know, there's quite the sort of more industrial IoT stuff or some of the medium-sized things, this makes sense. So now you can build architectures which are running partly in the data center, partly at the edge, partly at the customer premises. And then one of the ways that we bundled this up is to put it all in a box, which is the called Snowball Edge. And it's a 50-pound instance. It's like an Amazon region in a box. It's all secure and everything like that, but it has Lambda in it. And you program it on your console, in the cloud, and then this box gets delivered. It delivers itself. And so we've got 100 terabytes of disk and an instance, and we have our microservices now distributed to on the plane, in the boat, at the bottom of the cell tower, in the back room of the store, collecting video of the people walking in and out. This is a really interesting paradigm now, because now we have this little microservice functions, and we're pushing them everywhere. So the blog post I wrote before the most recent one was just called Lambda Everywhere, and it was, there's something interesting here, because we have the same API, the same programming model for absolutely everything. Just one more comment before, and then we'll go to some Q&A, which is that, I've referenced Lego bricks quite a few times. People say, well, but Lambda Everywhere, whatever, but it's an Amazon-only thing. Well, Lego is really a Lego-only thing, right? What's the alternative to Lego? I guess there are probably some, but they come and go, and no one can really remember their names, right? Right? It says there's a dominant supplier of little plastic bricks that are standardized, right? And you just get on and use it, and you could rebuild it with some of the bricks, or you can make it out of your own modeling clay if you want, but it's just so fast to use standard bricks that everybody knows, right? So what we're seeing in the, a lot of customers going, it's just so fast to build that I should just build it. And I'm not going to worry about the fact that this is now an AWS-only feature, because it only took me a week to build it. And if I need to move that to some other provider's roughly, functional equivalent, that's only a week too. Or I could handcraft the thing for 6 months. Or I could build it twice in 2 weeks, or build it again if I need to. So the speed of development and the core of these little functions is really the core of your business logic. So we're down to almost pure business logic. And that business logic is fairly easy to move around. So I think what we've got here, and this goes back to the first talk yesterday, about don't worry so much about reuse, think about replaceability. How easy is it to replace something? So these are systems that are very fast to build, they're easy to replace, and you should just leverage, Lego bricks and build everything out of these things and go really fast and figure out what it was, and then come back and say, okay, this piece here, I do have like a million requests a second go there, I'm going to handcraft that into some custom code. But this thing over here, I'm going to deploy, a machine learning classifier in a Lambda function that whenever it sees an image, it tells you what's in it. Those kinds of things are trivial to do now. All right, let's do some Q&A. How much more time do we have?
At least 10 minutes.
Okay, about 10 minutes more for Q&A.
So, are there any questions?
Hi, thanks for the talk. You were mentioning about machine learning and that you're doing as a hobby. Have you thought of meshing machine learning into Lambda functions? Probably some sort of pre-behavior that it understands that, hey, I need to do something and I get ready to, I start up all the virtual environments before it's actually done. Have you thought of anything? Is that something that's coming up?
There's a few different layers here. The whole machine learning, artificial intelligence space, there's really three different layers of it. One is the university researchers who are trying to invent new algorithms so they can have their name on an algorithm and become famous and write the paper and go to the conferences. And they're really motivated by, becoming that professor or whatever, right? And that's a lot of the, MXNet is a from CMU and University of Washington, and there's a whole lot of research there. So we're trying to encourage the researchers to play around and come up with new stuff and make get it more, to be more intelligent. Then there's the frameworks, right? There's things like MXNet, TensorFlow, Theano. There's a Cafe. There's all these names that you'll see once you get into the space, and each of them is good at different things, right? We picked MXNet because it's scalable and a bit faster, and we were able to sort of build a consortium around developing it, right? So those providing that as a toolkit to do arbitrary things, it's easy to package that up into a Lambda function and then have a library of Lambda functions. They call these things a model zoo. So once you've trained a model, you just put the model out there. This is a model that knows how to recognize trees or, you know, cats or people or something. You know, the image one examples are very easy. And then on top of that, there are services where you don't even have to deploy anything. So we have one called recognition with a K in it. And if you send it an image, it'll tell you what's in the image. And it'll tell you how old the person is and whether their eyes are open and whether they're wearing sunglasses and is that a beach behind them. And you just get back this JSON object that describes everything about, or that's the Eiffel Tower or whatever, right? You know, it just recognizes whatever's in it. And there's this massive library of pictures that we're training this on all the time. Right. There's another one for speaking, there's conversational ones. So some of these, we're starting to see them appear as services that you can just use as Lego bricks. And there are some of them where you want to build your own custom thing. Maybe you want to run it as a Lambda function, or you want to run it as a service. Maybe you train it using a container because it takes a day to train. And then that produces a little model which you embed in a Lambda function, so every time you use it, it runs more quickly. So those are kind of the three different paradigms we're seeing right now. And there's just huge interest in industry. I mean, all kinds of people, traditional industries, are realizing that they have an immense amount of data that they can classify with deep learning systems. Deep learning is really about images and video understanding, and machine learning is more about sort of more instrumentation. Any question?
Okay.
Hi, you mentioned like expected behavior of requests. Can we expect like machine learning for pattern recognition and requests? For say, maybe right now we rely on search queues or memory to increase the amount of machines. Maybe we can use machine learning for pattern matching to know, every time at 12, a lot of people will open up my website, and maybe scaling is done before it actually happens.
Yeah, so using machine learning in operations of infrastructure is something I'm starting to see people doing. Few different areas there. One is, if you're releasing a new version of the code, you go through this canary test, right? You can do signature analysis on the canary using deep learning or machine learning. That's actually more machine learning, really, because it's like error rates and memory sizes. If it's an array of numbers, characteristic numbers, that's typically a machine learning problem. And there are definitely people doing that. The Netflix have a thing called Spinnaker, which is a delivery pipeline, and they didn't open source the canary analysis piece of it because it was too tangled into their own systems. But there's a company called OpsMX that has actually produced a machine learning system that plugs into Spinnaker and does that. The other thing I've seen in this space is event correlation. So you've got a stream of events happening, you know, like logs. Your system's running and it's spewing out log messages and events, right? And you look at these events and you try to decide whether your systems are unhappy. And if anything goes wrong, you get different events. So you can train the system to say, this is normal behavior. Yeah, this code generates these. Yeah, it does exceptions every now and again. Doesn't matter, right? But when it does this kind of exception, something bad's happening. So you can actually start doing that kind of stuff. There's a company called Big Panda that does event correlation, and they take your massive event streams and they break them down into incidents, and they're using deep learning for that. And then in the more trying to analyze what to do about it, there's a Instana, it's probably somebody from Instana here, it's a local application performance monitoring company based in Germany, and they're doing deep learning and machine learning to try and do better operations on what's going on. So I think there's a lot of application here. The interesting one is if we get to developer tasks, like you have a really intelligent assistant saying, no, you're using that Java function wrong, or you've just put, you know, that pattern is a buffer overflow pattern, don't do that. You know, we could start having more intelligent advisors to guide us as we build systems, and then eventually we wouldn't need developers. So maybe.